Welcome to Ancestral Health Today, evolutionary insights into modern health.
This episode of Ancestral Health Today is brought to you by the Beekeeper's Granddaughter. With tallow that is a beautiful, all-natural skincare alternative using only the highest quality ingredients. The beef tallow comes from grass-finished cattle and is wet-rendered to remove all odors and impurities. Essential oils are then added for their medicinal properties to create thoughtful, bioavailable, and healthy handmade skincare. Organic cold-pressed jojoba oil and raw manuka honey are added and whipped to create a silky, luxurious texture. The products range from anti-aging, antioxidant, to anti-inflammatory, and much more. And they smell absolutely delicious. The balms can be used on all parts of the body, including the hair, to moisturize and repair. Please go to thebeekeepersgranddaughter.com and use the discount code AHT15 at checkout to receive 15% off of your first order. And don't forget your Christmas presents. Hi, everybody, and welcome to the Ancestral Health Today podcast. Today with us, we have Angie Alt. Angie, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks so much.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you for being here. I love to let the guests do most of their introductions because you're the person who knows yourself best. So if you could please tell our audience a little bit about yourself and the history on how you got into ancestral health and the paleo and autoimmune world way back.
Yeah, so I guess, you know, my journey started, I think we're getting close to 12 years ago now. I have three autoimmune diseases, celiac disease, endometriosis, and lichen sclerosis. And I went through a period in my late 20s and early 30s where I kind of got rapidly much more ill while I was living in West Africa. I got evacuated multiple times for health crises. And kind of after more than a decade of being sick with undiagnosed celiac disease, I finally got a diagnosis in 2012. And shortly after that, I found and adopted the autoimmune protocol, or AIP. A lot of your, you know, listeners probably know about it. And it was brand new at the time, but I thought that I would give it a try to see if it could help me heal. And it worked very well, much, much better than I expected it to. Within 6 weeks, my gluten antibodies had dropped by more than half. By 6 months, it was like having a new body. and by 1 year, I decided to kind of change everything about my life to concentrate on helping other people learn about, you know, dietary and lifestyle changes that they could make to help better manage their autoimmune diseases. So from there, I became a certified health coach and a nutritional therapist. I eventually partnered with Mickey Trescott, and we ran autoimmune wellness for a lot of years together. I also developed health coaching programs that were eventually used in partnership with doctors and microbiome specialists to do research that helped show the efficacy of the autoimmune protocol. And I helped train other practitioners from kind of across the health and wellness spectrum about how to use the protocol. And then, about November of last year, I decided to step back from my role in the community so that I could kind of focus on some new aspects of health and wellness.
That's wonderful. And I'm one of the AAP certified practitioners.
So, yes, Isabel is one of our students, an amazing student at that.
Always great to get to talk to you because that's really important work. And you spent a lot of time in that, doing that work and refining the program and reaching out to people to make sure that a lot of people were aware and included and being able to bring it to the community.
Yeah.
So can you tell me a little bit more about your time in that world and also how, looking back, you see that, you know, there was a, it was a reflection in some ways, and in other ways, if it was not a reflection of community, what things do you think you did great and what things you wish could have been better in terms of community work?
Yeah. By the way, I really appreciate this question. I think it's a really good question. It's good to reflect on this after more than a decade of that work. So I think there was or there is like a very great need among those with autoimmune disease to find support and approaches outside of our conventional healthcare system, because our system is, as you know, designed to address acute health issues. You know, if you've got a broken arm or a heart attack, our system will definitely help you and help you well. But when we have chronic illness or chronic disease, our system is just not very well suited. And a lot of people with autoimmune disease are just kind of drowning trying to get help in that system. So I think that what we built reflected a real community in that we addressed that need. Nikita Valario is the woman who coined the term community care. And she says that part of her definition for community care is that it involves a commitment to reduce harm simply by being together. And I think that we created a space where folks could find support and they could find new approaches. They could learn additional steps that they could kind of take on their own to help manage their autoimmune diseases. I think it, you know, kind of offered some hope. So I think we were effective in that, in reducing harm just by being together, by creating a place, even if it was virtual, where people could kind of get that kind of help. On the other side, though, I think especially early on, I was so focused on just getting the information out there for individuals to act on that I didn't consider the barriers that exist for so many of us to do any of those actions on our own. And I think after I started running my group programs and just getting to observe so many people at once trying to make those changes, I saw so clearly that there was greater success inside of a community. And that helped me see that we needed to leverage the community to address the systemic issues that were making everyone unwell. Again, to Nikita Valario's definition of kind of true community reduces harm, I don't think we were leveraging the community to reduce harm yet, to reduce the systemic harms, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. What do you think our ancestors were like from a community perspective? Because there's a lot of emphasis on the food aspect of ancestral health and also the autoimmune and paleo communities. There's a lot of focus on food. Mm-hmm. And community is not a topic that is at the forefront of the discussions. Mm-hmm. So what do you think the communities were like in ancestral health? What information do we have? And what do you think we can bring to the modern world from that time that can have a greater impact on health outcomes?
Yeah. You know, when I think about ancestral health, personally, I really think about Native American peoples because my own heritage is reflected in that. My grandfather was the last member of our family to be a recognized tribal member. So that's really like, you know, that really is what comes to my mind. And recently I've been reading the book Braiding Sweetgrass. It's by Robin Wall Kimmerer.
It's my favorite book.
Oh my gosh. We could do a whole other podcast episode just about this book as well. But, you know, she's, Ms. Kimmerer is a botanist and she's indigenous, and something that she writes about in the book that is like blowing my mind right now in terms of approach to community is her experience trying to learn her tribe's language. And the reason she's trying to do that is to prevent the language from dying. But she writes a chapter in the book where she describes how indigenous languages pretty much universally have a grammar of animacy, meaning that the way they speak refers to things that we don't see as alive in English, as alive, as beings. And, you know, for instance, like an apple, when you speak about an apple in her native language and her tribal language, you would say apple that being is, you would recognize it as a living thing. And I think that teaches us a lot about how our ancestors approached community. They spoke over and over about their fellow beings, and it changed how they treated the planet and our non-human inhabitants of the planet. I think that if I'm not suggesting that we're all gonna, like, you know, stop speaking English and, you know, speak other languages that use this grammar of animacy. But I think if we thought about community in that way, it would change so much that would be better for our health. You know, if we saw our, you know, rivers as alive and as beings that have to be treated in a certain way, if we saw our soil as alive and needing to be treated in a certain way, that those would have direct impacts on us in terms of food and water health. So that's one thing that I think is really interesting about how our ancestors saw community. I also think that we don't have to go really far back into ancestry. We can see examples of how our ancestors approached community by looking at the Blue Zone studies that are recent and now. And I think with the exception of maybe the Blue Zone community in Loma Linda, California, most of those Blue Zones are from cultures that have ancient roots, and all of them make social connection a priority. Where in our lives, we make work a priority. We say a lot in our modern culture that we prioritize family and in our social connections, but we don't. We prioritize work above everything. And I think that's really important, having that safety net and social connection is really a key to health and longevity.
Yeah, that's really important. So how do you think there was a pivotal time that sort of thrusted you into being much more centered into the community aspect of health and well-being in general? I know that you said that, you know, you observed a lot and you realized that there were social determinants of health and that there was so much more impact in community. But I think it was also surprising to a lot of the people who follow you that you sort of left the autoimmune paleo work that you were doing and that you have had a really dramatic shift, if you will. So was there a catalyst for that to happen?
I think for me, the shift personally, like kind of internally, started to happen around 2018. It was kind of a slow build to that point. And then from 2018 until I actually made the announcement to make the shift last fall, that was like a 4-year period. So I really wrestled with that decision for a long time and really, really thought carefully about it. I don't know if there was one particular thing that occurred at that point when I started to kind of make that internal shift, but it does go back to my experience with like a very high volume group health coaching program. I mean, over the course of my program, about 2,500 people went through the process. So I had this like very unique opportunity to observe what thousands of people are doing in the middle of their health journeys. And especially because I was focused on people with autoimmune disease, I saw that most of them were in a really desperate place and they were doing everything they could. They were trying so hard to balance their lives and all these multiple overlapping responsibilities with their deteriorating health. And they were so overwhelmed trying to navigate our systems, which are really inadequate for support. And I just realized that no amount of individual action was going to be enough to deal with the systemic failures and that we needed stronger community action if we really wanted to heal. That really started it for me. And I think by 2020, in the midst of the pandemic and all the racial justice uprisings, it really crystallized. And I knew we really needed to shift our conversation.
What do you think that people who are embedded in this community and who really, really plays a lot of emphasis on health, and who do a lot to, you know, maintain their health, to improve their health, to get out of illness situations, and a lot of them can do better in order to have the impact that is not just individual. If you were to create a system for, you know, allowing people to be able to transform the health of the community, where would you start? Where would you go?
I think that I would start by encouraging people to question what they believe about health and wellness and how it's achieved. I think it's difficult to take a community-based approach if you're kind of unwilling to examine and possibly relearn what we've been taught in a really hyper-individualized society about how health and wellness is achieved. I think that's probably the first step. I think from there, the next step is to then start having the conversation, adding your voice, speaking up about what you see in terms of broken systems, recognizing if you have any privilege or any platform, whatever size, you know, if you have 100 followers on Facebook, you know, that's a platform to speak up, and use that to highlight some of the inequities that exist. We can't move on to fixing the problems unless we acknowledge the problems. So it's kind of having that conversation. I feel like people kind of overcomplicate the steps that need to be taken to start moving towards a community-based approach. We have to start with a conversation that will allow us to take collective action towards, you know, what is going to be major social change, you know.
There is a lot of resistance to that. There mm-hmm. is a lot of hyper-individualism. There is a lot of saying that if you are not improving your health, it's because you're not doing the right things. You're not disciplined enough. You're not just paying attention. You're brainwashed by, you know, the food industry. And there's a lot of blaming that goes around in terms of why things are not working for society at large. And if somebody comes at it, you know, with an open mind and looks at those issues, then yes, you can see a lot of it. But there are a lot of people who are stuck in that belief, and like you say, question what you have come to believe, and that happens at all levels. But how do you integrate that bubble, that type of, you know, mindset? That it's very difficult to get out of, and start showing people that, you know, doing something like that is beneficial for the entire population. Mm-hmm. How do we get people to move past those beliefs and into that type of action?
I mean, first of all, you're right. I mean, I really want to validate that. You're right that it's really hard. It is really, really hard. It's especially hard to be kind of on the leading edge of trying to make that change. You know, if you're in a bubble, if you're in a space where that's not really well accepted and you're trying to like be the first to speak up and lead that conversation, it's really difficult. There will be a lot of pushback, and I definitely don't want to give the impression to the ancestral health, you know, community that this will be like, you know, super easy and everybody will welcome the conversation, that it won't be that way initially. But I think, you know, it could help to start by sharing examples of when the individual action is not going to be enough. It's, you know, if people have concrete ideas in their mind about these scenarios that arise where individual action isn't going to work, I think that can help them start to see the truth of this and shift their mindset. So for instance, like, you know, an example that I saw recently of the like hyper-individualism personal responsibility message, is the Washington Post ran a headline in their climate solutions section that read, "Your body can build up tolerance to heat. Here's how." And I mean, that's like really wild. And it's implying personal responsibility for surviving climate change rather than recognizing we need to overhaul the way we're doing things on the planet. We keep asking individuals to become more resilient so that a few can continue to benefit financially instead of collectively kind of demanding that we change so that it will benefit all of us. Another example would be that, you know, in the US, our groundwater is being rapidly depleted. And that's happening all over the United States, but it's especially acute in the Southwest. And we all know in the ancestral health community that water is absolutely the basis of life for all of us. There's nothing more fundamental to our health and wellness than having access to clean drinking water. But if our community keeps focusing on individual actions that are kind of like higher up the hierarchy of needs pyramid, I would think about things like an example might be, you know, we're spending energy teaching people how to hack their macros to maximize their energy. I'm not saying that that's not a worthwhile thing to do at some point, but we're preventing pouring our collective action into something as basic and critical as fresh water for all people. We can't take enough individual action to deal with the heat emergencies. We can't take enough individual action to deal with depleted groundwater sources. We need to do that collectively.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. I grew up in a society that was very, very much community oriented and helping each other. And, you know, I sometimes sound like a broken record when I go over that because there was so much opportunity for everyone to have access to so many things, just not at the perhaps the level that we're accustomed to. But there was a lot of happiness and there was a lot of lack of, you know, illnesses. And when somebody was ill, the community would rally, you know, and help that person or that family out to make sure that they were taken care of. And I see people breaking down because they are on their own. You know, families live far apart. Mm-hmm. And even if you are within a physical community, your neighbors are not necessarily, you know, a tight knit community. You see mm-hmm. them eventually and you say hi when you go by, but it's not, there's no that closeness. Mm-hmm. So in the direction that we're going, how do we look back and start to integrate those ancestral practices in a meaningful way? Like, what do people do first? Where do they go next? If someone is interested and looks at it and says, yeah, you know what? I really need to help my community and I really need to make this, you know, a community effort, not just what I'm doing for myself. What are the practical steps for them to get started and go there?
I think, you know, so, this is one thing that I'm trying to kind of advocate with, you know, simple conversations about different subjects in the new space where I'm kind of writing about community care. And I think that it's about slowing ourselves down, being okay with small steps, and simplifying as much as possible. So for instance, in your neighborhood, that might look like, you know, going and knocking on the door of one neighbor and introducing yourself and sharing a little bit about yourself. Or maybe you're out walking your dog and you see another neighbor walking their dog, saying hi, making sure they know your name, making sure that you know their name. It might start as simple as that. And again, to the point that I think people overcomplicate, we have to speak to each other. It starts with just speaking to each other. And maybe from there, it turns into sharing a meal. I mean, back to the food emphasis in the ancestral health community. If we believe food is medicine in this space, I think we need to expand that belief to understanding how much community is medicine. And then if you combine those two things, sharing a meal, I think that is actually very powerful in terms of health and wellness and building that connection in real life, you know. So small steps, say hi, make sure your neighbors know you, make sure you know them, maybe, you know, extend that to a backyard barbecue invite, you know, share some food together. Those are the real steps. You have to have connection before you can then mount into collective power. So I think it starts really small and simple.
How about the people who are already there? They're, you know, they're friendly, they're very much connected in their neighborhoods and their maybe work environment. How do they grow that community aspect?
Yeah, I think from there, once you have real, genuine connections, then start to have those conversations. And maybe, you know, like the examples I gave before, maybe bring up some of these things that are affecting everyone's health and wellness, but we can't individually do enough to address them. Start to come up with ideas. How will you help each other reduce harm about that? How can you expand that bigger? You know, I hate to sound like a little bit too simplified by saying have the conversation, but I do think that's part of our problem. We don't speak about these things to each other. You know, for instance, recently I wrote about climate change and being a little bit afraid to talk about it because we are kind of taking a little bit of a, like, that's a Debbie Downer conversation approach, right? Like, we're afraid to speak about it with each other. But we got to get through that part and speak together in order to address anything.
Yeah, absolutely. And the conversations that are happening are the ones about culture wars, whether you believe that this is the approach or you believe that this is the approach, and not having that communication, which is absolutely essential to community. But we're bombarded with that message online and everywhere. So how do people get over that barrier and, you know, set aside what could be? I know that not all differences are superficial. There's a lot of, you know, ingrained beliefs that can be very harmful. But there's a lot of just superficial barriers that are just manifested in culture wars. How do people overcome that and move past it in order to have deep meaning conversations?
Yeah, I mean, I think one way is to focus on the reduce harm part of community care. So let's say you get to know your neighbor and you guys are on speaking terms, you know each other's names, maybe you've shared a couple meals together, backyard barbecues, whatever, and you're trying to kind of move into how are we going to reduce harm, instead of, for instance, focusing on, you know, why climate change is happening and who's to blame for climate change. Maybe you say to your neighbor, oh, you know, it seems like the heat is getting more and more serious in our community every summer. Do you have any ideas about what we could do to make sure that all of our neighbors have proper air conditioning? You know, focus on how are we going to reduce harm and try to have the conversation there. Be, you know, solution oriented to the thing that is affecting everyone's health and wellness, and start there rather than start with, do you believe in climate change, or who do you think is responsible for climate change? Like, let's stop having that conversation. Let's start having the conversation about how are we going to adapt and help everybody, maybe in our cul-de-sac, you know, or on our block, be safer. You know, could we check up on our elderly neighbors and make sure that their air conditioning is running well? Or does anybody in our neighborhood not have enough money to pay the power bill in a critical time when they need air conditioning? How can we, like, maybe we can raise funds together and make sure everybody's power bill is paid?
Yeah, that's absolutely amazing. Really practical steps to
start
take.
Start with reduce harm.
Yeah. So let's shift a little bit to that junction of food and autoimmune and the community aspect of it. So one of the things that I think about a lot is the fact that there's a lot of fear about food that can really block the community aspect. But as you know, with the work that you did for so many years, there are real consequences to, you know, the types of foods that we have access to and that we eat in the food environment. So how do we overcome that aspect of, you know, I'm going to a backyard barbecue, but I'm gluten-free and I can't have this and I'm, you know, I can't have nightshades and all of that. And you have people who don't necessarily understand where that's coming from. And that can become a barrier sometimes to that community aspect. So how do you navigate that with people, and especially for people who don't have access to what they may need at the moment in order to improve their health?
Mm-hmm. So first, to the navigating it, if you have some specialized, dietary restrictions, I kind of hate to use the word restriction. It's not a restriction. It's really about, health maintenance. But the way that I have always handled that over the years and encouraged other people to handle it is to try to encourage in your community those kinds of events where you all bring food together, potluck style events, picnics, barbecues, things like that, because that gives you an opportunity to bring some of your own food and you don't have to go into a big long conversation about I need to be gluten-free or I need to be whatever. You just bring your own food and maybe people are interested in it. A recent example from my own life, my neighborhood celebrated its 50th anniversary and we had a big grill out. You know, the whole community was invited and there was a dessert contest. So I made a gluten-free peach crumble and that's what I brought. And I ended up winning and I didn't tell anybody that it was gluten-free. I didn't mention any of that. I just put it out and I was like, enjoy everyone. And people loved it. They were just like totally into this peach crumble. And I didn't bring it up as something that could be a barrier to us connecting. I just said, let's share some food. I brought peach crumble, I think that's one way to address that side of it. When we're talking about folks who maybe need access to foods that could be beneficial to them and they don't have the access, I think it's really important for those of us who are in a leadership position or as practitioners to recognize that we might need to modify how we're talking about food and how we're talking about accessing food. Maybe that means like sharing ways that the template that you're encouraging can be shifted to meet different income needs. For instance, at one point, Mickey and I with Autoimmune Wellness, we used to do the Autoimmune Wellness podcast. We put out a season where we brought on a social worker who talked about, utilizing food stamps to go as far as you could. We put out, blog posts where we were like, this is one way you can modify things. Here's the biggest impact things to focus on. You don't have to do this, 100% perfectly for it to move the needle. Trying to do things like that in a community together, this might again be a reduce harm conversation where you say, maybe you reach out to another friend and say, I see that there's, some of our friends are having trouble accessing all the food they need. What can we do about that together? Can we raise some money and go out and get those foods? Can we start a food pantry that offers that? I know that there's a food pantry, I believe they're located in California, called Porch Light, and they specifically collect food for those who have allergies and intolerances, but also can't afford, to go to Whole Foods and load their cart up, right? So maybe it means, coming together and collectively doing something like that.
Yeah, really all very practical steps to moving forward. What would you say would be the government role in all of this? And how can people in the way of building that community get involved and shifting the structures that are in place so that there isn't so much friction for people without access to be able to implement, you know, the steps that they need to improve their health.
Yeah. I mean, this gets into the trickiest, hardest to move piece of this whole thing, right, Isabel? I mean, I think that we have to really carefully research the candidates that are being elected in our communities, you know, starting with our local level, going to our state level, and then obviously to the federal level, and understand really what their positions are and what their qualifications are for addressing these things, making sure that we're electing people who are going to advocate for that kind of change. I think you want to try to identify the leaders who are going to see that we need a bottom up system rather than a top down system. You know, I think we all see that the top down doesn't typically work. It's not meeting most of the needs of the, you know, vulnerable group at the bottom. And a successful society can be best judged on how well they meet the needs of the people at the bottom. So finding candidates who are aligned with that kind of thinking and are willing to really go to bat to try to shift that. And then, yeah, again, I'm really like hammering this drum, but it goes back to the conversation. We have to have conversations together with our friends and our family, our neighbors. You know, maybe you're going to have that conversation even in the virtual world, which does have an impact on our real world, and say, like, these are the things that are making all of us unhealthy and unwell. What kind of changes do we need to advocate for so that this can improve? I think we, you know, in the United States, we kind of, at least we used to be taught that we shouldn't talk about religion or politics ever. But I think we didn't develop then good skills for having these conversations, and we avoided them until we got into a space that's really dangerous for a lot of people and leaving a big, big section of our society behind and making all of us sick. So we have to be brave enough to start having that conversation and raising those issues so that we all get on the same page.
How about people who are already where you are, people who recognize this? They are all invested. They recognize that the way that our ancestors lived in community, in communion, the way that they raised food, the way that they took care of each other, the way that they slept, the way that they worked, they, you know, all of it worked in a way that made societies healthy. People who are already there, but they are lost for what to do because they are also trapped in the go, you know, society. They have obligations and they have children and jobs, and, you know, your schedule is totally full to the brim on a daily basis. So how can people start making a shift that is impactful within their conditions that they're in, that they're recognizing the need is just being able to fit that within everything that they're doing?
Again, I think this is start small, start slow, simplify, you know, be okay with that. It's, I think it's really important to recognize that any step we take in the right direction is a worthwhile step when we're operating in a system like this. You know, you have to recognize that you alone overnight cannot change it all, and you can't just kind of, you know, run yourself into the ground to try to get there either. That won't actually serve anyone, including yourself. So being okay with the smallest step that you can take within a broken system. I think that's really important. You know, I think those of us who are probably already here probably feel an immense amount of pressure to try to, you know, fix it overnight. So just being okay with being able to take the smallest change and the smallest action, I think is really important. And doing what you can to simplify your life in a way that frees up space to focus on this more and more, you know, it's not always realistic. I think if you recognize that you have more privilege, even if it's only temporary, that could be leveraged to help address these problems, you should take it. We're in a moment that could use all hands on deck. So if you have that kind of privilege, you should take it. In my particular case, I'm in a position right now, it is going to have an end point, but I'm in a position right now where I can spend almost all my time focused on my community and focused on this messaging. And I want to try to maximize it while I can.
Absolutely. And we've talked about from the perspective of someone who can and has the ability or the privilege to be able to do things, whether financially or reaching out. But what advice do you have to people on the other end of the spectrum? You know, let's talk about somebody who doesn't have a lot of money for food, but has a lot of conditions and the need to address, you know, lifestyle interventions. That person perhaps doesn't get a lot of sleep. Maybe that person has to have two jobs. That person lives in a crowded city without a lot of access to nature. And, you know, the idea of, you know, go spend time in nature is just not something that's feasible. How does that person start to reach out instead to those who are able to help without feeling like they're asking for charity, without feeling like, you know, they're just asking for a handout? How does that person build community from the need perspective, not necessarily to take advantage of it for themselves because they're in that situation, but to also expand that access for the rest of that community?
Yeah, I mean, this is a really vulnerable space to be in. That is a really, really vulnerable space to be in. And it takes just an immense amount of bravery to reach out and say that you have any need in the first place. And try to connect with others in a way that might be meaningful beyond just yourself and your own immediate need. And I have to be careful I don't get a little emotional, Isabel. Like, I have so much compassion for people in that position because I have had a part of my life where I was in that position. You know, when my daughter was very young, we spent the first 5 years of her life on welfare. I worked a night job overnight. I got off at like 3 o'clock in the morning. I had to be in class at school at like 9 o'clock in the morning. I seriously got like 2 to 3 hours of sleep a night. It was really, really hard position to be in. I think if a person in that position is able to kind of summon the courage in the first place to reach out, that's already a huge step in the right direction and a huge, huge win. And it's helping by being open and honest about the need they have. It is helping push our societal conversation or our cultural conversation about the negative consequences of hyper-individualism. Like, they are doing something really, really courageous, actually. So I think it's there. It's just saying, I have a need, you know, how can we figure out how to meet it? Like, for me at that time, one of the things I had to do was say to my family and friends, I can figure out a way to use the broken system that we have to help me get childcare during the day, but I need childcare in the middle of the night because that's when I have to go earn money. And can we piece together a system so somebody is with my child and she is safe and taken care of while I go earn money? And it paid off to be vulnerable because I was able to stitch that together. And it made me closer in some cases with the people who stepped up.
That's another aspect where the hyper individualism that we are so accustomed to doesn't even let us see. Like, I grew up in a multi-generational family, and I have been able to craft that now with my children. And I know that people think that it's like, it's a crazy concept. Why don't they want to go away? Or why do you not want them to be away? But if people only realize the difference that it makes in our day-to-day life, mm-hmm. like when I'm working like a crazy person, I have somebody that I can say, can you cook tonight? And still have, you know, a healthy meal. We have dogs and there's always somebody to take care of them. And even without considering the helping aspect, the amount of time that we spend together as a family that is mm-hmm. so joyful, that, you know, has so many benefits, it's incredible. But I also understand it's really hard to do when you have grown up used to the concept that, you know, you want to do your own things in your own way 100% of the time. Mm-hmm. And bringing that balance just doesn't seem to be possible when you're having to compromise with other adults, mm-hmm. you know, in the way that you do things. So, but a lot of cultures, you know, other cultures have that. And I think that in terms of mental health, in terms of general health, and in terms of just pure life satisfaction, they seem so much better off than we are as a society because of that.
Yeah. I mean, you've shared with me before about your arrangement with your kids as well. And you know that I'm like super into it. I think it's so cool that you guys have done this. And part of the reason I think that is because actually American culture is kind of weird about the way that we don't encourage any multi-generational living and kind of, a lot of mutual, help and reciprocity across a family to, you know, make it so that everybody in the family can live more successfully and more happily and healthfully. I mean, you know, in terms of ancestral health, one of the things that we do the most backwards and that's detrimental for our health and wellness is that we strive to do so many things on our own that in ancestral communities, they did all together. You know, there was a whole collective of people that addressed, you know, making sure there was food on the table. There was a whole collective of people that addressed raising a child. And we focus so much on forcing an individual to carry all of that load. No wonder so many of us are sick. I mean, that is an immense amount of stress. And I know the ancestral health communities is, you know, really big into managing stress in order to, you know, maintain our health and have better longevity. And that is one source of our stress that we are so, like, you know, compartmentalized in our own little basically islands. If we shifted into doing things collectively, it would be so much happier and healthier.
Yeah, I definitely agree. So if you were hypothetically made president of the United States tomorrow, and you had the power to shift systems, and your main priority was to build a healthy and happy society with a focus on ancestral health, what would be the framework? What would be the structure? Where would you start? And how would you build it all?
Oh my goodness. That is a big question, Isabel. Well, first of all, for your listeners who know me and follow me, they might be surprised to know it, but I would never, ever become the president. I do not want to be a politician in any way, shape, or form, despite how outspoken I am. but if I became president, you know, I would probably do a lot to shift how we handle healthcare. I would probably want us to go to a universal healthcare system because so many people are shut out of getting even the acute care that they need, let alone any care for chronic issues. And you know, a lot of people don't engage in preventative healthcare because they can't access the system, they can't afford it. So I would probably start there. I think we would save ourselves a lot of money as a nation if we made sure people got care before they developed diseases instead of after. So I would probably do that. I think that I would probably want to put in place a system that offered really high quality universal childcare because so many people in our country can't access that. And it's such a high amount of stress trying to best care for your children while you earn a living. And I think if we had really great centers where our children were happy and healthy together, that would create some community connection. I would want to do a lot to help improve our food system and our water quality. I think those are base of the pyramid type of needs, right?
Yeah, those are really, really important ones. So are you sure you don't want to run?
No, thank you.
Yeah, those are really, really critical. Angie, thank you so much for doing this and talking about such an important aspect of health, which is community and how we exist within our communities, not just within our close ones, but within the communities in general, and how that affects the entire ecosystem and the rest of the non-human communities that surround us and that our ancestors have made such a big part and such a reverence towards, you know, the rest of our history. So that's really, really important. Can you tell people where they can find you and follow your work?
So I'm writing now on Substack, so they can find me at substack.com/AngieAlt. The name of my Substack there is Notes from a Neighbor. Just having one conversation at a time about these topics and how to shift our thinking. I'm hoping I'm giving people some language for having the conversation that I'm really emphasizing that we have. And they can also find me on Instagram at angie.alt.
Amazing. Thank you so much for being with us today. We really appreciate it. And I hope you have a beautiful time in community and that people really follow what you're doing and learn, you know, some practical steps and some really important ways in which we can make our ancestral health really community health. Thank you, Angie.
Yeah, thanks for inviting me on, Isabel.
Thanks for joining us on this episode of Ancestral Health Today. We hope you enjoyed our discussion on how evolutionary insights can inform modern health practices. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast to catch future episodes.